Hi there folks, in today's demonstration I'm going to show you how we can overcome a limitation of the update event action in Power Automate. If you've watched my previous video on how to enable users to sign up for an event using a Microsoft form and Power Automate, you may have experienced the existing attendees in an event receiving an update email every time a new attendee is added to that event. Well, in today's video, I'm going to quickly demonstrate that issue, but then show you how we can overcome it using the Graph API. And then if that's not enough, there is a hide attendees feature in a calendar, which enables you to set an event hidden or anonymous so that other users can't see who's in attendance. We can also do that using Power Automate and this Graph API, and I think it's quite a handy feature to ensure that your other users of this event can't see who's attending. Now, if you haven't already, I would highly encourage you to subscribe to my channel. And then without further ado, let's jump into my demonstration. So I'll start first off in my Outlook calendar, and I have a new event configured here. I'm the organizer, and I've invited my other self at demobird365.com as an attendee, and it's poor old Demo Bird that's gonna get these updates every time we add a new user to the event using Power Automate. So in order to demonstrate that, I have a very basic flow. It's all based on a manual trigger where I'll ask for an email address. I then have the event ID in a compose action, and then I can use that to get all the event details from this get event action using this event ID. And then finally, using the dynamic data from that get event, I can update all the required fields, the subject, start time and end time, the time zone, and then I can include the existing attendees in the form of required attendees and append that email that we pick up from the trigger. So if I go ahead and test this, and I'll be able to demonstrate the poor old experience that Demo Bird will get when we add a new attendee to our event. So I'll go ahead and invite Henrietta to our event, and I'll run that flow. And if I quickly jump onto my calendar, we should see Henrietta being added onto that event. If I then bring up Damo's email, we can see that he's received a new event email despite already being an attendee to let him know that Henrietta has been added. Again, if I jump onto that flow, we'll go ahead and test it, and we'll go and add someone else. This time, how about we go and pick Dave? So I'll go and add Dave to that event, and again, watch that calendar. We can see Dave is added. I bring up Damo Bird's email, and I've received another email to let me know that Dave has been invited. So basically, the first person that's invited to this event is going to receive all subsequent emails to let them know of all the attendees. So how can we resolve this using the Graph API? Well, if we have a look at the documentation, and I'll include that in the description, it states here that if only the attendees property is included in the request body, then the meeting update will only be sent to those attendees that have changed, which is exactly what we're looking for. In terms of the details on how to use the API, we can see if we scroll further down, we have an example where we can send a patch and include those changes. And one of those parameters that I want to highlight is the hide attendees parameter, which of course, if we jump across onto our calendar invite here, we can see we have this option to hide an attendee list. So this is one of the advantages of using the Graph API versus the standard connectors. We have the ability to set some of those parameters that are not otherwise available. So if we jump onto our Power Automate Cloud Flow that I built, the alternative solution, you can see that again, I've started with a manual trigger and I have that event ID in a compose action, but it's next that I use the send an HTTP request action that lets me patch to this Graph API. And that's where we use the event ID from the compose that will enable us then to change parameters such as the hide attendees. So I thought this was quite a handy feature. If you add this in at the beginning of all your flow runs for updating an event, you'll ensure that the attendees are always hidden, and of course that event will remain anonymous. If you forget to set it manually when you create that new event, you've always got this action here that will ensure that it's set to true. But that aside, we're here to find out how can we update the attendees list. Well, the first part is to create an array that includes a single object of an email address and the type set to either required or optional. Now, it's not as hard as it sounds. Maybe it does look a bit complicated, but I have written a blog post with these details so you can easily copy it. But there are also examples on the Microsoft documentation. But quite simply, you need this array containing an object that has the type, required or optional, and then this other object here of email address that includes an address key. And then here I've inserted my dynamic email. Now, once we've created this new attendee array, we need to then join that with our existing attendees. And of course, in order for me to do that, I need to know who else is going to be attending this existing meeting. And that's why I now have another send an HTTP request, because I want to get those existing attendees. And so, like before, I'm using that same endpoint. I have the event ID there, but I have a select that enables me to select specific fields from that event. And I'm bringing back a whole host of information, but to be honest, I could get away with just returning attendees if I really wanted to. And then, of course, the method here is a get. So this will return all of the attendees for the specific event, and with that information, we can then create a new attendees object based on a union. So what I'm doing here is using these squiggly brackets, you can see I've defined an object. I have this key here called attendees. And then after that, I'm bringing together both the output from the action above based on the body attendees, and then the output from our array that we've created above here. And this union expression will bring together both the new attendee and the existing attendees to create a new object with this array of attendees. This is all written up in my blog post, and hopefully it's enough information to enable you to try it yourself. Once this is all done, all we need to do is send a final HTTP request to that endpoint, a patch, and of course the body is based on the output from this object above. Because based on this documentation, if we scroll to the very top, it says if the attendees property is the only item in the request body, of which of course it is. We've created this attendees object, and that's all we're passing when we do this update request. So let's go ahead now and add my colleague Alex to this invite and see what happens when we use the Graph API. So I'll go and pick Alex here, we'll add him, we'll run the flow, and then I'll jump across onto my email at damobird365. So if we sit here in the inbox, we can see I've received no further updates. That's because the Graph API will not send an update to the existing attendees. If I jump across onto my calendar and open up that event, we can see that Alex has been added, but also if I go to edit and then look at the response options, the hide attendee list parameter is now set to true. So if we jump onto my Damobird 365 again, and I'll open up my calendar, I can open up that event, and I can see that I am the only attendee. That's because the hide attendees parameter has been set, and I no longer see who else is attending this event. Jumping back onto the original flow, if I expand the manual trigger, we can see that we've captured Alex's email address. And then further down, if we have a look at our first send an HTTP request action, we can see that the hide attendees property has been set to true, which is why I don't see any of the attendees. And when I looked at the calendar, that property has now been changed. When it comes to composing a new attendee, all I've simply done is passed that email address from our trigger. Of course, that could be from your Microsoft form, and that's enabled me to create this simple array of our new attendee. Our next action, of course, is based on the existing attendees, and if I expand the output, whilst we can see within the body we've got the start and end time and location, the key thing we want to identify or observe is this attendees array. So within that array, we have all these objects, including the existing attendees for that meeting. And at this point, we don't see Alex. Again, if I scroll further down, I then compose this attendee object, which will now include Alex. So it will bring together all the attendees from the action above. And then at the bottom, we can see we now have Alex as part of that attendee list. And then our final action is just passing that attendees object with an array of all the individual attendees, including Alex. And that's what allows us to update that attendee list, but subsequently not send out the invite to everyone who's an existing attendee. So that marks the end of my demonstration. I've actually got another use case for Microsoft Forms that I hope to release a new video for shortly. It will show you how potentially you can terminate or turn off a Microsoft form based on the number of attendees or number of responses. So for instance, you had a Microsoft form, you're only allowing 10 people to sign up to your particular event. When you hit the 10th person, you can automatically disable that Microsoft form and send the individual that signed up afterwards that unfortunately we've reached capacity. As before, I hope you've enjoyed today's demonstration, and if you've not already, make sure you like and subscribe, and I'll hopefully see you again sometime soon. Thanks for watching. Cheers.